Thank you so much for joining Discover Church Online, where you get pastoring and mentoring anywhere, anytime. It's such a pleasure to be with you. Today, I want to tackle a simple topic that applies to anyone at any age. It's about parenting, living in a home. How do we do this? It's very simple, really. The Bible gives us instructions in Proverbs 22, verse 6, train up a child in the way that he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. There's no greater dream for a parent than to have children, than to raise children who grow up to obey God, pursue God, and fulfill God's plan for their lives even after we're gone. I mean, there's no greater joy for a parent. But how do you achieve that? It's simple to read, it's simple to say, but it's hard to obey. Otherwise, we would have Christians raising godly children who are going to church, you know, long after they graduate school. But that is simply not the case. So what is failing? What is going on? I want to raise two issues that are very easy to identify and easy to correct, but somebody has to tell you. You know what you know, but you don't know what you don't know. So you need somebody to mentor you and to pastor you, and hopefully you have that in person. If not, then you have a mentor online here at Discover Church Online. There are two things that we've done that I think has been successful, because basically I just look to what God does, and that's my perfect example of a parent and a leader, and a pastor. Just try to emulate what God does. The closer you are to God, the more you have the right tools and examples, and you're equipped to be able to parent and to lead. So we have a one-year-old who's been potty trained basically since 10 months, 10 months of age. I know that's probably astounding for some parents to hear, because they have 3, 4, 5-year-olds who are still in diapers or in nappies, as we say in Australia. So what's the difference? The way we parent her is the same way that God treats us. God gives us a lot of freedom. Have you noticed that? Boy, God gives us a lot of freedom. It almost seems like he's not watching us. He is watching us. He knows our every move, our every deed, our every word. And yet, boy, he sure gives us room to breathe. He gives us room to make our own decisions, and he watches it. He's not waiting to smack you the moment you do something wrong. So I think some parents become a little bit of a totalitarian and think that being a godly Christian parent is to enforce rules in a very harsh, dictatorial way. And then some parents just confuse their own wishes and desires and dreams with God's precepts and God's principles and rules. Your desires as a person does not equal God's rules to a little child. So you've got to ease up on that if you're a bit of a, a dictator in your home. God is not a dictator to you, is he? He can be. If you act that way, you're going to reap that. Someone's going to be a dictator to you. Everyone reaps what they sow. But I like to sow a lot of freedom. So how did we get a 10-month-old baby to be potty trained so quickly when so many other kids are in diapers at 5 years old? The key is freedom. That's all it is, freedom. What is free for a child? To walk around without any nappy, without any diaper. It's a very unusual thing, isn't it? To walk around with a diaper. If you're an adult, would you like a diaper on you? Of course not. It's very uncomfortable. It's not nice to have something wet, in something bulky. I know that it absorbs a lot of the wetness, but it's very bulky and very strange. And so what we learn is, if we give our Amber Radiance more freedom, and she can roam around, and she can wear, their training pants, that she can feel when she wets that, it's wet. It doesn't prevent her from feeling the wetness, which is what a diaper does. Then she herself decides, that's uncomfortable. I don't like that. And she will go, she is like a Asian word for going toilet. And she will say, I want to go she, and we will take her to the potty. And that's become her choice. That's empowering her to make the decision that I would like to be comfortable and I like to be clean. Does she make mistakes? She does. And do we get angry? Never. Never. It's such a mistake when parents flip out on minor things. Maybe it's an inconvenience for us when you're training a child to be free and she's got only, a cloth on, an underwear on, or maybe nothing on because she's just, with us roaming around in her own house. Yes, it can make a lot of mess. She will start wee-weeing or she-sheeing, suddenly on the floor. And you have to clean it up. But you know what? You just smile and say, ah, no, no shishi right now, no shishi on the floor, let's go potty. And she gets it. You repeat that only a few times, and even a 10-month-old baby gets it. So freedom is very important, and freedom is messy. Freedom will create messes that God has to clean up, you as a parent has to clean up, leaders have to clean up. If we give our team members some freedom to create, to make a project, to do a design, a lot of it is not going to work out. Some of it is not going to be usable. But we don't go harsh and punish them. We let them flourish and we let them try. And we need to give feedback that it's not good. Are there times to be more stern? Of course. But it should be extremely rare and very serious. I don't think you want God to be stern and hard on you every single minute. I don't think that's going to be a healthy thing. So freedom is what we know from God is such a great parenting and leading style. A lot of freedom. Give a lot of freedom, a lot of trust, a lot of love. Now here's another thing. Kids, when they're young, of course they're hungry all the time, they're feeding on breast milk all the time, but when they transition to more solid foods, they tend to get picky. Some kids are picky, and some kids don't want to eat. And then they would go starving. You need to try to do something. So one style of parenting would be force the kid. You have to finish what I give you. My will is the law in this house. And it's very harsh, very dictatorial. I would go so far as it can become very satanic because it's a spirit. It's a spirit that imparts it, that spirit. I want my children to be free in their hearts. I want them to feel such joy being in the home. And I don't want that kind of ugly spirit anywhere near us. So what do we do to help Amber Radiance eat? It's really simple. Because she would not eat, you know, what we put on the spoon, what we decided was we're going to put two things in front of her, right there in front of her, and just wait and see what happens. Because that's what God does. God puts things in front of us, and he lets us choose. And sometimes he just delights in seeing what we would choose. It's not a right and wrong every time. You know, it's not life and death every single time. Enjoy the process. And so we put the food there. And you know what we found? She always picked something. She just wanted to have the choice. She didn't want to be spoon-fed. She's not the type of person that wanted to be, so dependent. She wanted to have the power to choose what is she going to put in her mouth. And so without fail, she will eat something because we don't force feed her. We allow her, we present to her some good healthy options, and she always takes it. And in fact, we notice that if we don't force her too much, we just continue eating ourselves. Whatever is in Papa's bowl, she wants that one. She's such a Papa's daughter. She just wants to copy me. I walk around, I hear these little feet following after me. So it's very easy. You know, children love you. Children want to grow up to be like you. And so if you're not harsh and dictatorial and you're kind and loving and you act like God, which means you're going to have a relationship with God, you have to read the Bible on your own, you have to pray on your own, then your children will grow up, as the Bible says, trained up in the way that he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Because that love is stronger than anything else. That home that has peace and security is stronger than anybody else's voices. Doesn't matter who comes along in the future. They will have been trained in the way that they should go. Now, there's one more thing that I notice, that parents just need somebody to come alongside and say, hey, you need to tweak this, change this, and they realize, oh, I get it. So the first thing is freedom, a lot of freedom. Now, some parents are overboard. Before I get to the next point, I do realize some parents are too free. What do I mean by that? Usually it concerns money. Some parents buy their kids or grandparents buy their grandchildren anything they want. That's a mistake because we use money to reward good behavior. Remember, we earn money because we've solved the problem. We've done something good for someone in the economy. And so we need to teach children that as far as money goes, yes, we provide food and clothes and we do all those things happily, education, but there's a time to learn incrementally that money is a fair reward for fair work. So if you don't do the work or you even do worse, you disobey and destroy things, you cannot have some of these things. But we never take away what belongs to them because that's a violation of property rights, human rights, trust, love. So a lot of parents do that. Kids do something that they are displeased with, then the parents say, to punish you, I'm going to take away what property belongs to you. That's such an injustice. It will create anger, bitterness, and hatred in the children's heart. And it's probably going to be directed towards you when they're older. So you see a lot of these kids that, you know, they grow up in homes where the parents say, I raised them well, I love them, I don't know why they don't call me anymore, they don't want to talk to me, because they could not trust you. Because if you can have your property violated in your own home, who can you trust? So we never violate property. You know, we say that, I've said that for years and years, since the days when Alexis could write. I said, I will never read your diary. I will never look at your private stuff. And to this day, I don't do it. You know what she does? She happily shows me what she'd like to show me. And I don't violate it, not even tempted to do such a thing. Because if you can't be safe in your own home, then your home is no longer a refuge, no longer a castle. It's very, very ungodly. All right. So we're very trusting of God. God does not violate our rights. So don't be too free is what I'm saying. Don't just buy anything. Use money as a reward system, but don't steal kids' stuff or withhold what rightfully belongs to them and say, well, that's my punishment for you. That's just unfair. You know, if let's say that you did something wrong and your boss says, well, I'm going to steal your car. I'm going to steal your car. I'm going to take the keys. I'm going to steal your car. I'm going to give it to another employee, even though it's your car. You would cry foul. You would say, you don't have a right to do that, even if you are a boss. Even if the Bible says I'm supposed to submit to my boss, you don't have a right to steal my property. So it's very important. Use money as an incentive to reward, all right? But you don't withhold or you take away stuff that already belongs to them. That's an injustice, right? The second secret that I have to training up children in the way that they should go, and not only for your children, but for your whole family. I have the pleasure of seeing all of my family come to know Jesus within 1 year of my coming to Christ. And I don't believe that's an accident. I did something that is a bit of a secret, but it's good for you to apply. For me, I made sure that anything to do with God was associated with pure pleasure. That's right. Everything to do with church was pure pleasure. Anything to do with the Bible was pure pleasure. I would never, ever raise up God's name or the Word of God in any negative context. And I find a lot of people succumb to this where they can end up having a fight on the way to church, or they have a fight about church, or they come back home after a church service and they have a tiff between, say, a couple, you know, a disagreement. And then they say, well, the pastor said this. And the other side says, yeah, but you don't do what the Bible says. Well, wait a second. You're in a negative, you know, environment, in a negative situation. And then you bring up God. Well, that's going to make you, that's going to associate God with something negative. Why would you do that? Church is pure pleasure. And I've had to tell couples, I've had to tell people, please don't bring my name into your arguments. If you're having an argument, that's your problem. I didn't create that. The Word of God didn't create that. Maybe it reminded you of something. Maybe it shed light on a situation you need to fix, but it's not our responsibility. You have a responsibility to fix your own relationship without bringing my name or God's name in it. So I think God says sometimes, leave my name out of it. That's what blasphemy is you bring God's name into a situation to control, to manipulate, to get your own way, and you say, God said. Now, parents, surprisingly, do this so often. This is why I believe so many Christian children grew up in Christian homes, and then they hate God afterwards. Why? Because parents inadvertently lose control of their own emotions, lose control of how to parent, and then they vent emotionally. And they say things like this. I've heard somebody said, a parent said to little children and said, are you a child of God? You're disobeying me. Are you a child of God? Are you a child of the devil? Wow. What incredible, I would call that witchcraft. I would call that sorcery. Because, and blasphemy, because you bring God's name into a situation where you're not in control, where the child is not obeying you, And maybe you've done something that is unjust. Maybe you've not listened, but you force your will on a child by saying, if they don't do what you say, they're a child of the devil. My goodness, that can create a lot of bitterness and a lot of anger in a child. Imagine if your boss said that. You didn't turn in your work on time. You didn't cross all the T's and dot all the I's. And they say, you remind me of the devil. Wow. As an adult, you would be absolutely floored. You would say, I don't want to work for this person, even if the Bible says I should submit to my boss. So we tend to know this with gender relationships. I think it would be very rare these days if somebody has an argument and then, you know, the husband says, well, the Bible says, wife, you are to submit to me. So I want you to cook what I want. I want you to go to the place I want because the Bible says you have to submit to me. That's nothing but abuse of the Bible. Don't abuse my Bible. Same thing happens when people try to teach about God, but they're really failing because they're associating God's name, church, pastor's name with negative things. Never raise up God's name or the Bible in negative context. When I bring the Bible to my children, oh, it's so positive. It's such a joy. It's the time for healing. It's a time for reconciliation. It's the time for forgiveness. If I say, you know what the Bible says in Ephesians 6, and they're in trouble, I bring it from the perspective of life. I say, you know, there's a reason why God said, honor your father and mother. You know, because this is the first commandment with a promise, that it may go well with you, that you may live long on the earth. God wants you to live long. Do you want to live long? Yes. Do you want it to go well with you? Do you want to make, you know, money and have wealth later on in life? My son definitely says yes. You know, he's very motivated. He wants to understand the economy and money and finance. And I say, you know, what God says, the first key is to honor your father and mother. I don't quote that when he doesn't do something that I want him to do. I don't quote that to pound the Bible. It's called Bible bashing. To bash him on the head, then he will have a negative association with unpleasant experiences with his parent and the Bible. Why would I ever do that? How foolish that would be. God doesn't do that. So make sure that anything to do with God, anything to do with church, anything to do with the Bible is always brought up in the most happiest, joyful context. And then people grow up realizing, wow, God was always a good thing in my life. That's how I grew up. Even though we were not born again, spiritual things were very sacred. And we would never just throw around God's name or God's commandments in order to get our way or in order to make up for our inadequacy to be able to control a situation or to be able to discipline an unruly child. Children are children. They're just going to misbehave sometimes. And that's not always a big deal. It's not the end of the world. It's not a statement about you. It's just children being children. So you need to learn to relax like God. Boy, God lets a lot of things happen, doesn't he? He's very cool and calm and collected. He knows in the end that he wins. Jesus, his son, wins. So you got to have a victor's attitude. You know, we are entrusted with such a responsibility, such a heavy, serious responsibility to nurture up little children in the way that they should go. And God will call us into account for that. And any leadership role, any position that we have, it is so serious. We will stand before God and answer what we did. And I would never want to be too harsh. I want to give a lot of freedom like he did. And if he asked me, why did I do it? I say, well, Lord, because you were that way to me. He gave me so much freedom. And I learned so much by making decisions on my own. And I learned to trust you and ask you. You see, if people don't ask you, you cannot really teach them too much. You have to wait for children to ask you for your wisdom. So you give them freedom to choose and to ask. I learned so much from you, Father, because of the freedom you gave me. And then I know that everything about you, every time I saw you, heard your word, it was always a pleasant thing. It was always a good thing. Even if I was down in the dumps, even if I was sad for something that didn't happen my way, yet God's presence, God's worship, God's people always brought a little bit more joy into my life. And that's what Christian parents should be. They should leave those wonderful memories in a Christian kid. And if you're not leaving those memories, then it's not really the child's fault. It is really your fault. You need to be looking at changing something in your life, probably getting closer to God, walking more like Him, changing your attitude or perception of how God is, because He's not this harsh ogre that is just stripping people's freedom away, stealing people's properties, yelling at them for the most minor infractions. That is not the God that we serve. That is not God the Father at all. And that's not what Jesus was like. So I hope that this was a good practical explanation of Proverbs 22, verse 6. So easy to hear, so hard to do, but I've given you two tips today on how to apply. Let's remind ourselves, train up a child in the way that he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Let's raise up disciples who are not just a flash in the pan, who are not just sprint runners, but marathon runners. Let's raise up disciples and children who last the whole course until they go home and see the Lord in heaven. Amen? You can do that. You can do that. I believe in you.